First of all, good morning. Thank you so much, Martha, for inviting me for this winter adventure in Montreal. It's my first time here. It's lovely. And this is a wonderful, you know, I wasn't going to miss this conference for the world or for, you know, my writing schedule for anything, because when I read your, you know, your blurb for that invited, I said, oh, my God, these people speak my poison. You know, this is my jam, forms and platforms. All right. You know, so I knew I had to come. I'm in a precarious position because I'm in the throes of finalizing and revising a whole, book manuscript, a monograph on that's using the Israeli case study of emergence from complete obscurity and what I call belatedness, you know, belated modernity. Anybody knows that second modernity is belated modernity. Israel is a very good case study for a hyper-marginalized, small, tiny, linguistically isolated industry that had no chance in hell to even dream of export, and emerging kind of overnight with format, what I call format dynamism, with this shift from Finnish to conceptual flows into global success. And I'll talk a little bit about the branding of Israel as like this format Cinderella in global television. And so it's a really good case study. But I have to say, I really don't want to write the book as like, look at the Israeli miracle, isn't Israel awesome? Because, you know, for many reasons, and also I don't think Israel is that awesome. But I think it's a really interesting case study for several things, and the type of dynamism that formats allow that was just unthinkable before the shift to a format-driven globalization. So this is, you know, this is one of the things, but it's actually because it was so marginalized and it became a global player that I think Israel is a good case study too, and I'm getting to my point of today, I'm sharing the theory part, to help us rethink how we need to conceptualize and think about formats. Not only as a trade phenomenon, although it is a trade phenomenon, our theory doesn't need to be a trade-centered theory. So this is the part that I'm trying to zoom in more on today. So basically, I'm saying we need a television studies, cultural studies type of theoretization of what formats are in order to understand why their trade, their emergence into tradable commodities, was able to so radically shift realities in global television. Realities that we all know in the kind of first 50 years of global TV, it seemed insurmountable, right? The dominance of American Finnish export seemed insurmountable. So that's the question I'm interested in. So quickly, you guys kind of know the context, the global format revolution, format trades transformed the global television scene. This kind of repeats what I just said. It created a brand new market, MIPCOM, which was forever the big trade conference, introduced, I think in 2000 and I want to say 4 or 5 or 6, introduced MIP format, a whole new market arena for exchange of formats. And so formats seem to offer a brand new way for television content to travel. Again, I'm trying to bring together a lot of different ideas from the book, so I will just throw out here, but is it really such a brand new way, right? My book will say not so new. And one of the signs of that new dynamism is what we call the rise of the small. One of the visible changes, small and previously marginalized players like Israel emerge into global export. And so there is a way in which we can talk about a decentering of the sources of innovation. So that's another lens that I apply widely to formats. You will see in a minute, not so much just about replication, but also about innovation. And actually in that productive tension between imitation and innovation that everybody in this room are more familiar with, I think, than most of the political economy folks that I, you know, many times end up on a panel with that talk about formats. Not Andrea, because she really you do audience, you do forms, but she knows what I'm talking about. All right, so Israel is this good example. So let me read you a little to stop my free flow. In recent years, Israeli television creative industries became an established global brand for television content innovation. While many factors influence the trend, there is no doubt that it's formats that allow this. The shift from finished to conceptual forms boosted Israeli media industry's export from $60 million to $380 million a year over the last 8 years. I threw numbers in, right? You guys might say, well, so what? $380 million is still not that big. And that is kind of a little bit of my point here. It may not seem very big from a US or a UK perspective. It is not. Because I think the radical example of what Israel can show is demonstrating that it's not just market measures that matter. Right now, with this, I mean, of course, market matters, right? So I also have numbers that show, you know, more traditional market success. So here they are. Where are we? So this is right. So $380 million a year. Though this number may seem insignificant from our perspective here, this unprecedented growth has radical significance in an industry that just three short decades ago seemed hopelessly isolated and marginalized. Formats catapulted the little country, according to Forbes magazine, to third largest provider of content on American television behind the UK and the Netherlands. So this is, you know, this is real, this is market. You know, here you go, you look at the US market. First place, UK. Second place, Netherlands. Third place, Israel. You know, the unthinkable. You know, just a couple of years ago. The WIT report that is presented annually at MIP format ranked Israel second after the UK for number of formats sold abroad between 2010 and 2014, and in 2015 as fourth after the US, UK, and Netherlands for the top territory of origin for format. Even more recently, 2C1 Media's annual survey presented in 2016 ranked Israel first as the hottest territory for producing and acquiring formats. Now, this is a survey that me and Andrea were trying to hack the methodology. You know, they ask executives weird questions, oranges and apples. You know, they're like, but one of the questions they asked him was, what is the hottest territory? And remember, it was like Israel, Turkey, and Asia. You know, so it's the methodology is questionable, but in terms of the buzz generated, definitely we see. So Israel is now so successful as branding itself as the it girl of format exports that recently the trade press started, especially in the US, started using it as a standard for comparison with new emerging players in the format arena, especially those who set their eyes on the US market, right? So then a Hollywood Reporter story in 2013 about Argentinian format exports trying to get into the US market pondered, is Argentina the new Israel? And a Deadline story discussing Turkey's advances in the same, that's my what? In the same lucrative space said, cited a executive on the floor of MIP format as saying, it seems like Israel, Turkey is the new Israel, which was the new Netherlands. So, what's peculiar here for those of us who grew up in a world of much stricter hierarchies of core and periphery is that Turkey and Argentina both represent bigger, older, more established economies. They have a much, you know, regional history of export of media products. You know, that's my like, huh? You know, is Argentina the new Israel? Argentina is the old Argentina. Argentina actually outranked Israel in the WIT report for export of formats ever. So what's with this discourse of is Israel the new, you know, is Argentina the new Israel? How did Israel manage to brand itself as this leader? And the lens that I think explains all of this is the lens of innovation. Israel companies are notorious for their efforts in branding themselves, but also, you know, they back it up as coming up with the most innovative. You know, they push in both drama and what we call digitally native, unscripted content, and that's part of what's going on here. So while that new dynamism in global television that Israeli television is a great example of is the direct result of the rise of the global television format trade, still I say understanding formats only as a market or trade phenomenon is offers limited explanations for this phenomenon that I've, you know, for the Israeli success and for the way that formats are understood. So in the MIP format panel the same year, Someone asked Israelis, a bunch of Israeli executives, well, what's in the water there? What's in the water there? And that's a question that keeps repeated. My favorite response came from Yoram Mukedi, who's executive in Israeli Hot Channel, and he shot back, it's not in the water because we don't have any. And so that threw into sharp relief all the things that Israel doesn't have. It doesn't have landmass. It doesn't have a culture of history of cultural production or export. It doesn't have all these things. And what it does have, and my approach to study this emphasizes, is a history of a set of attitudes, a deep desire to participate in a cosmopolitan, and I use cosmopolitan on purpose, not so much to, refer to Beck or anything like that, but to refer to early Zionist discourse, that, they saw the Israeli state as a state that would be a part of Europe, cosmopolitan production arena. In Herzl's book, I probably don't have time to go into that, but, predicted the state. He talked about the theater in Israel. You will have theater groups that would do high art, and they would not only consume European theater group, but they would tour Europe. So there was always this notion of as we say in Atlanta, the thirst is real. They really wanted to, always, there was this really fierce desire to participate in a global economy, cultural production. So, moving on. A trade-centered theory. So, although this is a trade from... Oh, I said that already, sorry. So, my issue with the trade kind of definition that we have for format, right? We have the Albert Moran, and again, I'm not trying to reduce Albert Moran's definition. He also, there's more there. But as a rule, the discourse, the kind of cliche discourse that developed around defining formats is that formats are defined, a show becomes a format when it is copied and replicated, right? And at that point, it becomes a format. But a TV and cultural studies approach would ask a different definitive question, right? What are formats before they can be commodified? So it's just a different lens, a different type of question. And I develop a more process-oriented definition. Instead of talking about formats as commodities, this is a complementary approach, right? I'm not saying let's not study trade and it's not important, but I'm saying we need to understand the type of commodity that formats are before we can understand what Joe Strobar's called affordances. They're affordances. They're allowing for things to happen that were just impossible before we had formats, right? So formatting as a process, through reading Williams, Fisk, and people like that, I defined it as TV's fundamental mechanism for generating and regenerating its cultural forms, or a mechanism of cultural form reproduction. Now, I'm using here... Hang on, I'll leave it up there because I see people are taking notes. This is very much based on a careful reading of Williams's Television, but also, even more at this point, I'm very excited about a 1981 book from Williams that's called The Sociology of Culture. And in The Sociology of Culture, people in this room might appreciate how much I enjoy to read Williams's dry theory, correct? He goes into great lengths, and this is not new stuff for us as people in, again, as I said, people in this room, people who have this training are not, I'm not trying to pretend like I'm making this up for the first time. I'm actually basically saying I am dumbfounded when I read Williams to see that this was not yet applied for formats because it's so basic for us, right? He talks about reproduction as a complex, contradictory process inseparable from innovation, changes, and the production of new original work, especially in advanced commercial capitalistic creative industries. All right, so reproductive forms, if you guys know that book, he spends a long time discussing how, for example, he takes Greek theater and shows all the way up to Shakespearean theater how the reproductive form of tragedy or comedy migrated through, so you can say it's transnational migration, right? So these are the kind of legacies intellectually that I'm interested in bringing into this discussion of format. So more from William, simple notions of reproduction can be especially misleading, he says. Indeed, most of the important art in the world can be properly referred to its shaping forms, forms which it often shares with work now thought unimportant. So, I tell my students, Shakespeare's sonnet, what a bad object. you take a format of 14 lines and you just put in it your new, you know, reproductive, you know, your new thing. There's a very, you know, it de-automatizes for them the idea that formula is bad object. And I really think that that legacy of formula is bad object TV still lives on in a lot of the literature and the conceptual frameworks we apply for television formats, because we overemphasize replication, remake, and repetition, and kind of forget that repetition is the only mechanism for innovation available in, you know, a medium like TV. And also, when we take that approach, and I'm kind of jumping ahead for time, we can see how this framework allows us to see how it migrates, how forms migrate between different platforms. So when you read Williams's book, Television, and he has this, I love the chapter so much, my students hate it, this meticulous chapter where he traces the received forms, he calls it, of television and how they migrated from radio, from the newspaper, right? News came from the magazine, you know, entertainment came from theater, and he traces meticulously how these forms came from before television into television. For us, it's also an opportunity to look, you know, it provides a framework to look at how it migrates into new platforms, right? So that's the kind of, this is why I get excited about applying that kind of lens. And it's not doing away with work like Jean Chalabi's wonderful book about, you know, format trade, when he applies global chain value and kind of, he says it's not political economy, I fail to see how, but, you know, it's like new neo-political economy. I love that he does that work, because I sure don't want to do that kind of work, you know, I don't like counting things and, you know, looking at markets, and I love that someone else, you know, I think it's a big enough field where we need to do these different kind of works, but I think that this kind of mass, this, it becomes the dominant paradigm, and it mass and you know, makes us not think about these kind of things, specifically in the literature about formats. So back to this quote from William, you know, most, he's basically talking about how reproduction is actually related to the innovation, right? So important art forms are, they're, you know, can be referred back to their shaping forms, which is often they share with work now thought unimportant, and also with the products of replication, right? So he's saying new important work of art are the product of replication, basically. Many major works are produced within and in a way because of the existence of major forms at the peaks of their cultural development. This from Williams. And then he cautions us, that's again still from Williams, too simple an understanding of reproduction can thus diminish these achievements, which in any general theory, he says, have to be seen as important production, emphasis in original, right? Production, not reproduction, made possible by a reproductive form. So kind of, I'll just throw in a couple more theoretical insight that I gleaned from television studies to help build this approach to format. William says, again, in television, he has this, he makes the argument that, and that's why I really enjoyed your paper about the smartphone, you know, he talks about how the state of mind of the people who developed television as a commercial form was that they will recoup their cost by selling sets. He talks about how they kind of stumbled into the crisis of, oh shit, we have to make content, sorry, we have to make content now, and it's more complicated than we thought. And he calls it the he doesn't really call it like that, but the fallacy of transmission notion, right? They thought we will transmit a lecture like me, right, here. Andrea was talking about how they were, you know, putting the BBC radio anchors and reading, and, you know, and they kind of stumbled onto the crisis of having to produce original content and how expensive that is and how difficult that is. And, you know, how do you then start to understand the medium of television itself, right? And one of the things I tell my students is that television is never a one-off thing, right? Even if you're going to be like, we want to show experimental films, you're going to be like, join us every Tuesday at 8 for 30 minutes of the most experimental form-breaking movies, because broadcast is just, again, at the context that it was that it evolved. So that moment that William says, you know, they didn't realize, I read it from a format lens as they didn't understand they will have to format for television every kind of content that's going to be on television. Fisk developed the notion of formula art. There's the in television culture, there's my favorite reading, is the chapter on intertextuality, where he basically said, well, genre, television is very generic. I think, you know, he's conflating genre and format, but, and he says, conventions are cultural, but formula is industrial, right? So formula is a translation of conventions into a production practice, if you will. And okay, I said that it's also a way into transmedia. Williams is tracing received from. So quickly, the study of the way I approach studying the Israeli case study through this lens. So you know, again, in Jean Shalabi's book, and I'm not trying to, you know, use him as the poster child for everything I don't do, but you know, he traces a history of format trades. You know, so for him, the history we need to tell is when did money first change hands, and it was between the U.S. and the U.K. And that does drive me crazy. And I told him so I can tell you. He then concludes, the history of format starts, it's a US and UK story. For me, this it doesn't, you know, I'm not satisfied with that kind of history. For me, if we only look at when money changed hands, we are savoring formats from a wider range of phenomena that they belong in, that are older than television itself, and are going to be newer than television, right? They also carry us into the future. And so I am looking at Israeli television engagement with popular formula art, taken from Fisk, the idea of formula art. I am not telling the history of when they started trading. I'm talking about that reproductive forms in a certain moment in time. My first moment is the 80s when the Israeli educational television, so I'll jump to this, right? National educational broadcast tasked with heavy regulatory, you know, they... A citizen-making boredom machine, I like to call the Israeli television. You know, we had one channel, and it was supposed to make us good citizens, right? And so the educational television that was ran out of the Ministry of Education office, tasked with teaching English and grammar and all sorts of things, they decided by the 80s that they want to go to prime time and that they want to do, of all things, a sitcom. They went to America and with, well, chutzpah, because they're Israelis, they improvised basically a Bible, not Bible study like people go to Israel to study the Bible in the Holy Land, but a Bible study in Birnbeck in LA. They taught themselves how to produce, how to format a sitcom, right? So they said to me, you know, they went on the set of three companies, but then they went back and did Israeli Father Knows Best, right? Because all they cared about was, and you know, this is how I discovered that they told me, we wanted to learn the format. So remember, Andrea, when I came to Roehampton, John Ellis and I had a discussion on whether or not people can just go out and do. And I said, you know, the Israeli, you know, he said, if anybody can learn how to do a format, then my students can do whatever. And I said, look at the history. Israeli people, people in Colombia, people in many different, in India, taught themselves by just by looking at television, but also by, you know, the Israelis with their professionalism. And that's one of the attitudes that I'm tracing to show why they were able to capitalize on format trades. They understood they need to go to LA and see how it's done. And then when they said, we went to LA, our studio was as big as the bathroom of the studio in Burnbank. And we got so depressed. But then, you know, we went home and we figured it out. You know, they built the sets. Like, so that's the creative skill that I'm saying I can trace back to that history that's working. Now they learn how to make on a shoestring budget a show, and I don't have time to show you a clip that I wanted to show, but a show that looks very much like a sitcom. So a lot of the discourse around that show was, how come it's the one first pioneering sitcom, also the first Israeli series ever, basically, and it looks so mundane. It looks so normal. You know, there is no other show, but it looks like just another sitcom. It's not that special. So that was kind of, you know, so applying a format analysis lens to that, that's, you know, where I begin my history and kind of explain all that theory to show why it's useful. So I know I need to finish, so I'm not going to go in too much into the two other case study, but so the book starts with that sitcom, and then it goes into the moment where the rest of the world started theorizing formats, which is the mega formats. But again, my story is going to be very different the way I tell the story of the mega formats. From a format analysis point of view, you now have time-space compression, right? The Israeli industry is now commercial, and all of a sudden, it's dealing with the same kind of technological challenges that change the audience practices, right? And so what happened with the mega format is that the industry is now much more transnationally integrated and is dealing with similar conditions of mediation and changes. And so the rapid spread of the mega format, and it's very important that the show I'm looking at is not, and this is the one, Kochav Nolad, Star is Born, it's not an idol show. It's an idol, what you would call clone, but the meticulous history shows that it, you know, they, and I have an article about homegrown reality, they grew it out of a local Zionist game show, Zionist musical game show that started from this nostalgic Zionist sing-along, everybody sing together kind of game show. And so the first season, they just said, let's bring contestants that can sing. And the last song, the last game, after they do the game show, they will sing a sing-off. And the reason they did that was they didn't know that people would pay for SMS. So, you know, that whole discourse of formats are reducing risk in a maybe a market like Germany. Yeah, it pays off to buy, you know, a big market. It pays off to buy already idol that's all made. Israelis, they didn't feel like for them to invest in buying idol was too much money. So they just kind of slowly developed it within. And that was the reason that this is my case study was that was the first show that was able to bring reality television into the market in Israel. Before that, nothing really caught. So this is my second one. And then the third, of course, is the rise of export, which I talked a little about. So, you know, I'll just finish with my big, these are, you know, some of the famous ones, of course. The one on top, Alliances, is Allegiances, I think, is called. They, you know, it's a spy drama, a Russian family immigrant. It was made in the U.S. It is now made in Korea, and they've made it a South Korea, North Korea thing. So there's an export from Tel Aviv to Seoul, and Seoul, if you know, Korea is usually selling and developing. They're not buying, but in that case. So there's a lot of dynamism. I'm assuming I ran out of time a long time ago, right? So, you know, all that dynamism that's coming out of Israel is well beyond just the sale of formats. There's migration of talent, of people, of money, of ideas. You know, you have now Israeli executives working and taking jobs in Spain, you know, just like Korean producers are developing in China. So that's the kind of dynamism I'm interested in. And I really think that that type of approach that is not a trade-based theory to study the trade, right, is useful. So I would love to hear if I convinced anybody in the room, because I convinced a publisher, but that doesn't mean that, you know, so I'm very thankful that you lended your ear for my my mess this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. So is there any questions, some questions? Yes, Andrea, one question.
Well, Sharon already knows that I very much appreciate your widening of the format concept, and I think it's really helpful and useful and necessary. But I still wonder when you, because you've done a lot of interviews with Israeli producers, mm-hmm. when you speak to them, do you know? Can you see any difference in their minds of, you know, whether they're producing something to be traded, you know, so conceptualizing a format for international trade straight away, or whether they conceptualize a show for the home market, and then, yeah, if they're lucky, it gets traded right. later
oh,
on.
I mean, this is a great question. I'm going to answer it in a completely different way, though. When I talk to the Israeli, you know, people like Keshet, they're like evolved from this question, actually, in a way. Right, so there's two levels. First of all, no. The first answer would be no. They, if any, you know, Avi Neil, who's the head of Keshet, is the most important person in Israeli television scene, and it's very, he has their way they think is so innovative, it's already very global, but that doesn't mean that the shows they make for Israel, they don't make for the Israeli audience. But they have this deep belief in the universalism of the Israeli audience in a way, right? They say the Israeli audience is cutting edge. It's the most sophisticated audience in the world. If we get them, we get everybody. So that's kind of like because they, in a way, they're denied the particularity of, but you know, in the way, so something like Homeland, right? They say that was the most Israeli subject material. For years, they told us we can't export films from Israel because they're just about the Holocaust and the army. And that was the reason that Israeli cinema didn't take off. Then we did Homeland. What could be more Israeli? It was a very Israeli story. It was just as Gilad Shalit, that was kidnapped by Hamas, was released, and it was about the three kidnapped soldiers. You know, he said, you know, who would have thought, right? But then we made the show because we thought it was a good story and a disruptive story and a kind of story that wasn't told. And so we think that a good story carries. You know, so they deny that that binary even exists. I don't know if that answers your question, right? They deny it. They say we make it because we don't want to do... Avi Neil says, I am not trying to create flow. I don't do procedurals. I don't care for flow. I disrupt every one of the texts as a broadcaster in Israel, and they're the most successful, and they get like 50, 42% sharing and rating. It's ridiculous. They're very dominant. They try to disrupt. So something like the A word, you guys may be familiar with the remake in the British, right? The A word, which is an Israeli show. A story about a small story, family in the desert, you know, periphery, and they have an autistic son, and they discover. He said, I read it, and I just loved that story, and it wasn't told in that way, and it's a slow build, slow burn story. And so we made it, you know, and we thought if we can make it in Israel and they love it, then we can sell it. We now have the confidence we can sell it everywhere. So, you know, they kind of deny that it matters. Yeah.
So Marta, one question.
Thank you so much, Haron. So I think, I don't know if it's a question or some remarks, so I really appreciate the fact that you want to bring back to television studies the area of format and not having it as a trade or giving it to economic or... I think the whole idea, so you stress the idea of repetition or formula art, which I totally agree with, and the importance of, this circulation, which is always innovation and repetition. We can find that also in Umberto Eco's famous article.
I didn't mention it, but Larissa and I were talking about that.
Which also makes us think about intertextuality and links with maybe other media which interact with television. So maybe I would like some, if you have any point to make about the fact that maybe format, you also mentioned the transmediality that we can bring back to William Cesare. So that's one point. Do you consider transmediality around formats and how can we use that?
Absolutely. That's a great question. You know, when I follow the objects of my study, they take me there. You know what I mean? It's like I look at, my framework, as I said, when I look at how Williams looks at Greek theater all the way to, you know, Shakespeare, and then the received form of television, how they migrated from older media into television, then for me it's very exciting because it exactly does away with the... you know, discrete kind of idea that there is television, and there's, you know, it provides a strong framework to then trace how forms migrate into new things. Israel specifically, as I said, the strength of the export comes from their investment in always trying to crack the new digital. So they do, you know, two innovative kind of export is quality drama, because, you know, In Treatment was a very pioneering show in that, alongside, you know, Norwegian, of course, and Danish and all of that. And, well, Ugly Betty was the big first scripted drama, but In Treatment was important because it was quality, but still highly formatted, because they cracked an idea that it's every day. And but I'm going into the other, right? The other thing that they really are pushing very strong on is digital. So Keshet, as a company, is very important to look at in that area. They do scripted, unscripted, and digital all in the same company, and they're the broadcaster, the dominant broadcaster. So when he talked about Homeland, he says Homeland doesn't look like a digital show, but the way we developed it, it was for an audience with a digital state of mind. He said, Avinir, he calls it DSM. So I have to disrupt them, and I have to provide for them the kind of text that would let them, you know, get out, you know, off of their phone, but also, you know, they developed it with a website and crazy thing. Now, the other important one is Rising Star, which failed. Rising Star was, you know, the first kind of, you know, they cooperated with Google Cloud, and they developed the app that you can vote on the app, and you see the Facebook face, you know, faces of those who voted, and a digital wall, you know, and the auditions are live. You are familiar with that. It was a bit of a flop because it was in the competition area that was just dying out anyways, but... the important thing with Rising Star is that they bought a high-tech company called Screens, and it's now a part of Keshet. And so, for example, Screens is now working with, I think, Telemundo. I'm terrible with remembering names of anything not Israeli. Telemundo, they are developing apps for their reality for La Banda. I do remember that. So if anybody's familiar with that market, they can tell me if it's Telemundo or the other big Latin American, right? So Keshet now are in the Latin American market. Whenever anybody wants to, their business in that area is to, they call it a native grown digital format, three screens, Right, so that's another part of the export coming out. So that what I'm trying to say, this is research I'm still, you know,
that ongoing. Grows in the country in which the format is adapted, or is it created
by? They market their services, and remember, and that draws heavily on the Israeli success in high tech, right? So one of the other arguments that I didn't have time to make was, you know, they were able to get global success in high tech, new technology, new media technology before television, because television is kind of a medium that wired to an older globalization and moment of modernity. You know, it was hard until formats. It was almost impossible to globalize television in that decentered way. So they're working together with the strong high-tech presence in the country. And so they're also offering a service of, we will come and work with Telemundo or whoever in the world to build, and they're working with Korean companies and in China to build your show, but to build it from the start as a digital three-screen experience. I don't know if I'm answering it.
Other questions? I have only one question, a short one. How does this TV industry impact feature films in Israel? I remember I saw some films on Palestine questions in a detective mood, which remind very much this series, which was screened later.
One of the ways there is a global, a more global. It's not as successful as the television, but there is a spike also in global production in Israel. One of the ways is that the regulatory body forces the Israeli television companies, the broadcaster, and a lot of them are also exporting formats, to invest in local productions. So a lot of the movies you see that are actually very successful from Israel are funded maybe by Keshet, or they're funded by... Mm. What's funny about that is, you know, if you look at the other broadcaster, which is Reshet, Endemol bought, and ProSieben bought that to fight Keshet globally. They said, we'll buy your competitor in Israel, right? So it's a very... So in a way, Endemol is paying... They are forced to put money into Israeli film that are very like festival films, right? So it's just so interesting, all these different flows that are happening that are, so that's one way that I can, but it's not very, these are very different circles, and the film people in Israel are very snobby about television being, you know, crap and shit, and it's this very, you know, not to badmouth Europeans, but it's this very European distinction of, you know, film is art, TV is crap. Of course, the TV people don't think that, and they say, look, everybody in the world are watching Homeland and watching, but can the farmers and the cowboys be friends question between film and television is still alive.
So thank you so much. We have a break until 11 o'clock. We start again at 11. On a une pause et on reprend à 11h. Hein?
So drink. No, kidding.